Now, the two US Navy sailors, Quartermaster Maurice Enis and Jamie Plime, who both experienced this radiation exposure. I don't know which one wants to start first. You've got 10 minutes to tell your story. Yep.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Jamie Plime. I'll just kind of give you a chronological timeline of what happened. We were already on deployment in 2011. We're about to pull into a routine port call in South Korea. We go to our navigation brief the night before we were going to pull in, and we found out that the tsunami and earthquake happened. Immediately, we knew that we were going to reroute the ship to Japan to provide aid and, you know, give them food, water. So we did that immediately. We probably got to the coast of Japan probably the day after it happened. We never heard anything about a nuclear power plant. We never knew anything about the possibility, let alone any kind of leak. So we were there outside. Our job as quartermasters is not only navigating the ship, driving, plotting our course and track, but going outside at the top of the ship to raise flags to communicate with other ships. So being outside, we were breathing in this radiation. We were handling flags, which are porous, very porous material, obviously. The ropes that we use to haul the flags up are polyester. So again, a very porous material that just absorbed the radiation. We didn't really hear anything for probably a couple weeks after about a leak in the power plants. And even then, it was just still considered kind of a rumor. The ship didn't really even go on lockdown, which I mean by that, like no one was allowed outside, probably until about a month and a half after March 11th. So we were outside breathing this in, handling stuff, handling materials, and just absorbing the radiation. I'll let Maurice talk about his medical issues that he's encountered, but I'll talk about mine. We didn't finish that deployment until October 2011, so we carried on with our deployment. About halfway through, probably around the summertime, my menstrual cycle just disappeared completely. And then it would come back and disappear and go on and off. And this happened until about the summer of 2012, where it came back in such full force that I was in and out of the emergency room. Once they thought they were going to have to do a blood transfusion on me because I had lost so much, I was still in the Navy for this past year. I got out this past January, 2013, so I was still getting Navy care for that year. I was already on the birth control pill, which I guess they would do to control that kind of menstrual cycle. So the only thing that they could do is say, this is called dysfunctional uterine bleeding, and we can give you an IUD with hormones in it. And so now that's what I have. It hasn't really stopped it. I still have this issue, and now I have to pay for the medical costs of that. In addition to that, in February 2012, I developed bronchitis, and then from February to the summer of 2012, I got it 6 times. I was sent to a respiratory doctor, and it was determined that I developed asthma. So a lot of people don't understand that once you get out of the Navy, you don't get any health care at all. If you retire and you stay in 20 years, you get health care. But we only did one enlistment. I did 5 years, he did 4, so we don't get that unless it's a disability, a service-related disability, which dysfunctional uterine bleeding does not really count as a disability as of yet. So we're still fighting that case. And this is also what we're involved in, a lawsuit against TEPCO for medical expenses that we're going to have to pay out of pocket for.
I'll speed it up because I know I don't have much time. I'll start with the beginning of my story where I received the radiation. A part of our job is we have to communicate with other ships using flags and semaphore and Morse code when we're doing special operations. And we store all our flags outside in a weather bag. We also fly our American flag, our ensign, at the highest point so people know we're the U.S. Navy. I was told by one of the higher-ups to go out and retrieve the American flag so we can give it to the Japanese as a friendship type of deal, like a gift. I pulled the flag down. It was flapping the wind and wrapped around me. It got all over me. I folded it up and took it down there. I gave it to them, and I'm not sure what they did with it, but I got off watch an hour later. I went to go get something to eat with one of my good friends. We stopped, I used the restroom, and we're just joking around because at the time there's still rumors going around about radiation being on the ship. And we're joking around about my growing extra fingers and toes and stuff like that. And we were like, let's stop and get checked for radiation, because they started setting up these little checkpoints all along the ship. And they're saying, it's just a precaution. You don't have nothing to worry about. If you get some free time, just go get checked out. And we're joking and laughing and walking over there. And he gets checked first, and nothing happens. He gets his hands checked, and nothing happens. And he's like smirking, like, I told you, this is a waste of time. And I get my boots checked, my pants, and then my hands. And as soon as they get to my hands, the machine just goes crazy. And instantly, like, we went from, like, smiling to just being nervous and scared. And they instantly told everybody to back away from me. They made a perimeter around me. And they marched me to a decon station. And the whole time they were telling everybody to stand fast, which means stay in your place and back up. And everybody's just looking and freaking out. And I had to hold my hands up, and I had bags on them. And they were telling everybody to contaminate the cell, everybody just get back. And we make it to the decon station, and I see there's a huge pile of clothes there from other sailors. And I go in, and they had to remove 3 layers of skin off my hands and arms. And it wasn't like back to back. They would scrub off 1 layer, and then I would have to wash off this orange grit stuff that you used to get off paint and oil. And then they would do it over again and then check. And we'd start the process all over. So in my head, I was just kind of praying that the machine would stop beeping so I could get it over with. Like, and nobody told me at the time, like, what was going on. Everybody just kind of told me just to stand there and be quiet and not to touch anybody or anything. It was almost like I had the plague. And finally, the machine stopped beeping, and they let me go back to my berthing. And that's when I got to my berthing. They called and asked me to come up on watch to relieve the people on watch, and they told me that I had received the highest amount of radiation out of anybody on the ship. And then later we found out that our work area, since it was outside, had the highest readings for radiation because of all our flags and all our line that we used to haul up stuff. And they cut off all the area to the rest of the ship.
Well, you've got a few symptoms?
Like 2 months after, a lump appeared on my jaw. And I went and got that looked at by the Navy medical, and they told me that there was nothing they could do about it while we're out to sea, that we'd have to wait for us to pull in. And another lump appeared between my eyes. I have another lump on my right thigh. As soon as I got out of the military, I went back to college, and I started playing college sports again. And I actually ran within like 3 seconds of an Olympic time for my track and field team. And slowly after that, my body just started to fall apart. It's harder for me to breathe now. It feels a lot like my lungs are too big for my body whenever I do something like strenuous. I lost a lot of weight from the time I was in the Navy until now. I got stomach ulcers.
Your hair?
In the last month and a half, it doesn't look like it, but my hair's started to fall out. I try to avoid brushing and combing it, and I'll wash it like every 3 days, just because I don't. It's like Navy tradition. When you get out, you grow out your hair and you grow out your beard, and because you're bald for so long, and it's just falling out now, and I don't want to speed that up, so I try to avoid it.
And what did you have to sign?
Like a little bit after we found out the ship was radiated and we had finished up helping out, we left the area. And before we pulled into our first port since the disaster, we all had to sign this paperwork saying that the military is not to be held liable for anything that happened, and we had to sign paperwork saying that we weren't sick, that we were okay, and that they did tests on us. And it wasn't like a yes or no type of option. It was just like you have to sign it.